Coast Live, recorded in front of a live audience. We're at the Brink Lounge, 701 East Washington Avenue, right down the hill from the Capitol Building in Madison, Wisconsin. We're your hosts. I'm Mary Gaines, and this is Chris Wagoner.
Thank you all for coming tonight. Beautiful night. Not a cloud in the ceiling, as they say. We're happy to be here tonight with Mr. John Masino.
And I'm very happy to be here with you two.
Thank you. Now, a lot of times we launch right into it, but I wanted to ask you, John is a widely known, iconic figure here in Madison and the region and in Wisconsin. We'll talk more about that. But I'd ask him to bring his electric rig. He plays acoustic shows too.
Yes.
But this will be interesting because it's going to be a big electric set here tonight. But it's just you.
Yes, a little bit different. I took some tracks from my first two albums and remixed them and left out the part I'll do tonight. So,
that's pretty cool.
Mr. John Masino.
Are we ready?
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you.
you.
Yeah.
Mr. John Masino.
Wow, that was awesome.
Thank you.
This must be a little bit like playing on the Charlie Rose show or something.
I see.
I don't know. I mean, we're sitting over here with our little clipboards, you know, and you're rocking out on this guitar.
Like. Are you guys, you know, what are you writing over there?
I'm writing poetry, actually.
Okay, poetry.
It was a poem.
I thought you were writing.
No.
Yeah. Mary, maybe you're writing a song.
Yeah, that's right.
That's it.
Let's go with that. You know, there's so many beautiful things about the way you play, and so many of them, I don't have a clue as to how you do them.
Well, thank you.
I mean, it's just beautiful. But like, the extra harmonic thing you pushed over there and it went up and knocked. I like, what is that?
Well, I don't know. It's a lot of having fun on the guitar.
Yeah, it's
a mystery. Really, what it is?
Yeah. Discovering things.
But playing guitar in this way, you know, people see, or people that maybe don't know about what the guitar players are doing, playing this style of guitar is a lot about knowing. Right, about what your the electronic gear too, right? I mean, what it's going to do to the guitar's sound and tone and.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you spend a lot of time trying to get it so you're controlling the sound, and you're able to get that sound for the lead type of stuff you play. You know, the sustain and all the effects. You know.
Yeah.
Right.
But I think also people think, it's an illusion. You know, they're just playing with a bunch of effects. It sounds great. It's like, well, no, you try it. You know.
Right.
It's a lot more than just punching
tools,
a pedal.
Good luck.
You know, you got to know how to use it and do it.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Because you can have all the equipment in the world, and it may not sound that great.
Right.
If you don't play good, or you know.
Right.
Yeah. Now, all the musicians, or the backing tracks, that's your band, essentially, isn't it?
More or less? The first four songs were a band I had for my first album.
Oh, okay.
And that was Rob Endres, my nephew, on bass, and Brian Dahl on drums. And I did all the other guitars and keyboards.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, okay.
So.
How did you do that? I know it's the miracle of technology, but...
The multi-track.
Yes. Yeah.
You've played in all kinds of bands for decades around the state and lots of brushes with fame and fortune. You are famous around here, but I know there were some real close calls that probably, you know.
Yeah, I had quite a few. I was almost the lead singer in Foreigner.
Oh, yeah.
Which was actually quite funny. I went there to audition for the guitar spot, and when I got there, they said to me, you can leave your guitar in the case because we heard you sing and we were actually auditioning you for the lead vocalist.
Wow.
And I was like, well, that's kind of interesting. I didn't really warm up for that. And they said, well, teach him the songs. And I was like, I think I've heard Feels Like the First Time on the radio.
Yeah.
But anyway, that was when Lou Gramm was going out on his solo career.
Okay.
And maybe another one I could tell you about quick would be my audition with Foghat.
Right.
I was in the top three in the nation. So, but I remained friends with Lonesome Dave Peverett until he died. And it was just great knowing those guys.
Yeah.
Great musicians. And so.
Yeah. But you're nominated in several categories in this year's MAMA Awards, the Madison Area Music Awards. And
you won 2010s.
2010
in
Best Guitarist.
Yeah, Best Guitarist. So. Yeah.
And the Whammies as well, the Wisconsin Area Music Industry Awards.
I guess I'm nominated for 2012.
Yay!
So I just find out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
But it's cool to see you out. And where are you playing with the band? Much too.
Yeah, I have my band. The John Masino Band, and we play all over. All the clubs in Madison, Middleton, just mainly around this area.
Yeah. What's the best website to find out?
Probably Reverb Nation, John Masino Band.
Okay.
All right.
Mr. John Masino. We'll be right back. That last chord?
That last chord, it was an A minor.
Really?
Yeah.
That all? No way.
Okay.
Woo! Yeah. Hey, speaking of that.
Yes.
The contest that you were in, the Guitar Center's King of the Blues contest in Madison, in Minneapolis, you won that in what year?
That was in 2011.
2000, man. Oh. That was a big contest. You were talking about this after the show.
Yeah.
I mean, before the show.
Yes.
Having a little problem with my timeline.
Just after, before. Yeah. It was
so
post.
Before, after.
It was not post, but.
Yeah. But it sounded really interesting. But, I mean, in typical in some ways like contests, right? I mean, where there was a certain amount of drama.
Yeah. There's definitely a lot of drama. And it's really hard to, you know, do these contests because, you know, you it's great when you win, but someone's always got to lose. And there's a lot of people that they work so hard. And every last one of them are just great musicians. And you have to applaud everybody for trying.
Right.
Right.
And I guess I was very lucky. I won the two Madison contests and Minneapolis. So.
Yeah. That's awesome.
That's pretty great.
That's no small feat. I mean, that's, I'm sure, especially in Minneapolis.
Yeah.
A lot of guitar players.
Tough competition. So each contest, it was like, I'm going to have to lift my leg a little higher.
Are you going to keep doing that?
They're going to have another one this year, and I'm going to do it again.
Yeah. You were describing, I mean, not to name names. I mean, if you remember his name, you can name it. No, there was a guy. So, you know, some of the contestants, you say it's rather subjective, too. You must be hard to be a judge because there are a lot of great players that play in a lot of different styles. And you're like, you know. But then some who maybe have this very technical mastery, but you realize in the end, really they're just kind of playing scales.
Yeah.
But as opposed to, like, bring, you know, long life experience as you've had from playing lots of different
A lot of bands. Real
and,
ideas.
It's really more about feeling, you know. I mean, you can learn all the notes in the world, but you got to connect them.
And play melodies.
In a way, Like that. So I try to get, you know, always strive to be more melodic, even though I play a lot of that stuff that you're probably like, you're not.
So when you guys play out in the clubs here, around here, is it pretty loud? That's a stupid question.
It's pretty loud.
Yeah.
It's kind of a guitar extravaganza. Yeah.
Do you dig that as much as you did when you were a little younger?
Yeah, you know, that's the thing about music. That's the reason I say it's kind of a timeless thing because let's say when Eddie Van Halen played the Eruption in Van Halen, well, you know, now it's years later and I still like it.
Yeah.
You know, I still play it. So music is one of those things. It's not like you get older and all of a sudden, well, I don't like that anymore. You know, I mean, so.
I guess I mean like the adrenaline of having your pants flap from moving some air on stage.
Yeah, I mean, it's not necessarily to be really loud. Yeah. I get kind of an odd guitar sound. I like this full sound.
Yeah.
Not necessarily just blasting loud.
Right.
Really, it's those darn cymbals that are the, that's the drummer, loud thing.
The drummer.
Somebody right next to you going, tsh, at a piece of tin.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. That's really true because we play in a lot of bands and I'm usually, you know, more or less a side guy except in our main band and I stand off to the side because I'm a side man. You know,
but when I'm sitting down, I force Chris to stand next to the drums.
To the drummer. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Because it's better than me sitting next to the drums.
We were in a recent band where I actually played guitar most of the night. I played telly most of the night and I stood in front of the drummer and I never realized as a guitar player why a lot of times they have to turn it up pretty loud. It's because they're standing in front of the drummer.
Well,
they can't hear anything.
Exactly. Yeah. You'll do a sound check and you'll think your stuff's all dialed in. It's I'm gonna keep it down tonight. And as soon as that drummer starts playing, you just slide back there.
It's not
ego. Let me
just
fix this.
No.
Yeah.
It's survival.
It's just the way it is. It is.
It is.
Just saying this for the benefit of the audience and listeners, you know, when they go to a concert, here you go.
Yeah. It's not against drummers. It's just the nature of the beast. Yeah.
That's right. That's right. They bang on things for a living.
They do.
It's not against them.
Drummers write in to John Masino at... No.
No, I can go to a shopping store and see people. Yeah, he played drums with me.
Oh, I bet.
You know.
Yeah.
Well, should we do another
one?
Yeah,
please.
Let's hear another one.
All right. This one's a song called A Long Time Ago. It's kind of your classic or typical blues rhythm and blues riff. Yeah.
If you're just joining us, we're listening to John Masino and the John Masino Band.
No.
Yes.
I was imagining you in a rock god outfit. We'll talk later.
Well, that was back in the 70s, you know, yeah. I had the big hair, you know.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of that.
Matt still got the hair.
He does.
Which is a good thing.
Yeah. What are some of the bands, seminal bands that you came up through, early bands?
Wow, that's
it's a huge list.
There was Cynthia and the Soul Asylum, The Cross, The Rack, SRO,
Punch?
Chunky Pie, Punch, Baby Fat, the Soul Band, and anyway,
yeah.
There's wow. just the whole list. I mean, yeah. The Rage from Milwaukee, Wisconsin,
right?
Many bands.
Yeah.
And the Gregg Clemons Band. We got signed to CBS Records in 1980, so I suppose I should remember that one.
Yeah. And you're on that LP, of course.
Yes.
It's on Nemperor CBS Records.
I want to go and look back at the pictures and stuff.
Uh-oh.
But was that the full touring thing? You had the big...
Do you have the bus and everything?
Well, we had two trucks, two PAs.
Yeah.
We had the Cadillac, the station wagon, and the 67 T-Bird with the suicide doors.
Nice.
So we had that was just for one band. But.
That's cool. Wow. I'm like, Cadillac, that's the way to go.
Boy. Oh, it was great. We would do like 6 to 8 week tours all over the place. Colorado, Montana, Texas. And we'd play with Ted Nugent and Head East and all those bands, you know.
Wow.
How was that with Ted, for instance?
Ted is so loud.
Speaking of.
He will kill small animals at 10 paces.
With his amp?
Yes, with his amp. He's so loud.
Oh, my God.
No wonder he got into hunting.
Yeah. He's Ted, he's an interesting guy. He drinks Werner's ginger ale. He's got to have it by the case.
Huh.
So
he doesn't drink liquor?
Oh, no.
Okay.
Ted, never.
I didn't know that. That's pretty interesting.
Oh, yeah.
He's naturally crazy.
Yes, he is.
You can go to madtoastlive.com and email Chris directly.
Yeah.
Bring it on. Bring it. Bring it.
Hey, the John Masino Band CD, really?
Yes.
Really? Really?
That's the new one.
Yeah, right. That is the new one.
And the reason why it was called Really was because...
Well, it's kind of a, you know, that whole thing saying Really, it's kind of a timely thing right now. I mean, everything in this day and age is like people say something, it's like, really? You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, we did a Katy Perry song on there, and people said to me, really?
Really?
And I said, well, it was like Carlos Santana version of Katy Perry.
Cool. So
that's what we did.
That's pretty cool. Yeah.
I wish you could play that on the show, but unfortunately.
Well, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But yeah, what else you got?
Yeah, let's get another one.
Okay, this is kind of a weird, moody one, actually, which I wrote this when I had a nephew that died back in 2004, 2005. And I wrote this for him. And actually, it's the title of the first album called Out of This World. you.
Out of This World. Was that called Out of This World? That was on the CD Out of This World. Right?
Yes, the CD Out of This World. Okay. I'm going to switch guitars.
Okay. And that was on your that was recorded in your home studio. That, are you still recording?
Yes.
Do you still have the studio?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I did the pretty much the whole new album there.
Okay.
We did the drum tracks in a bigger studio though.
Yeah.
I did the rest.
How was it? You spent some time also in New York as a session musician and playing out. How was that?
That was great. It was very exciting. I got to work with all sorts of musicians.
Yeah.
And it was really cool going to Greenwich Village and jamming with like people from the David Letterman show and those types of musicians.
Yeah.
And it was just really great. I got to do a lot of really cool sessions and stuff. I was very lucky. I had a friend, Mark Kaufman, that I went to high school with, and he said, come on out, and I got a bunch of stuff you can play on.
Sweet. Wow. Sweet.
Now, didn't your brother used to play in the band with you?
Well, yeah. In fact, I have my brother, Jeff. He plays bass, guitar. Now he's mainly a guitar player. I have a brother, Chris, that plays acoustic. Brother Michael that plays electric. My cousin Donnie Bakken plays electric. Nephew Rob Endres. And my oldest brother Steve, he played guitar. That's the reason I started.
Oh, man.
So I don't know if I forgot anyone. There's so many people that play in the family.
Family reunions must be really fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just bring guitars and...
Yeah. Just we had a... Actually, it was on WYOU. We had a... family jam show. Never heard so many loud guitars all in one place. We claim that we stopped the clock on the wall.
Probably.
And I kept thinking, God, we're out of songs and the clock hasn't moved, you know.
Uh-huh.
It's like we're playing all these songs. It's still 10 after, an hour later.
Yeah.
You know.
Timeless.
Yes.
Timeless.
So this next song is off my ESP album. ESP meaning extra soundtrack perception.
Oh.
Should we do it? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very cool.
Mr. John Masino.
Now, this next song. Well, I've got two, but song, we have to feature Mary Gaines on bass on the recording. And also Mike Massey plays the strings, but Mary played, he played fretless. You tune it like a cello. Which I thought was, wow. I was like, is that ever cool?
Thank you. It's kind of a weird thing I've always done. So I didn't have to relearn everything, you know. Kind of the lazy cellist. Yeah.
Well, should we do it?
Yeah.
Okay. Where are you? I can't face the world, and I believe. Thank you. So it's residuals.
I like that too. Yeah,
it's fun with the ring modulator.
Yeah.
I think someone just beamed into a chair over there.
I think so.
Then they beamed out. It did not look human.
Here's Mary's bass part beamed into a chair.
Well, thanks for coming on the show. I know we have one more too. Mr. John Masino here.
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks again for having me, Chris and Mary. I really appreciate being here. I'll leave you with a little song. I went to the Gulf of Mexico and I recorded some, what I call siesta wave.
Oh, maybe not. I'm going to do something else.
Thank you.
just got to ask you one thing. Did you play that in the 80s?
What?
That song?
Actually, I wrote that song when I was in seventh grade.
Oh my God, because I remember seeing you at festivals.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I see.
I just remembered this. We always used to come see you in your bands. We always had to go see the Masino band.
Wrote the music in seventh grade. Wow. Mark Everest wrote the lyrics, the singer from Clicker, and Steve Gunlock played bass, and Bob Cornell played drums on that.
Wow.
Thank you.
Mr. John Masino.
Thanks again.
You can go to reverbnation.com/John Masino Band.
Yes, Reverb Nation, John Masino Band.
All right. And that's to find out more about where he's playing and what recordings for sale. One right now, John Masino Band, called Really?
Yes. Really?
Really? And I'm sure available at live shows as well and on the internet.
Yes. Thanks for having me.
John Masino.
Okay. Thank you.
You can go to madtoastlive.com and hear most of our podcasts are up there. You can go to the podcast directory of iTunes. Listen to us on weekdays in the Madison area, localsounds.fm on your computer dial. Friday nights at WRT 89.9 FM at midnight. Special thanks also to Greg Ginter's Guitar Shop at Atwood Avenue here in Madison for the loan of some fine equipment this evening.
Oh, yes. I'd like to thank Andy LaValley, our technical producer. I'd like to thank Adam Beranek, our audio intern. Taylor Ryan, our video intern. The Brink Lounge. And Warp 89.9 FM, listener-sponsored community radio. Thanks for listening.
Good night.